super interesting article just came out in the New York Times where they asked 10 nutrition scientists about their pet peeves, the common nutrition myth they wish would die. I already went through, I agree with some, I have questions about others, so let's take a look. Myth number one, fresh fruits and vegetables are always healthier than canned, frozen, or dried. Yeah, I agree this is a myth. There are specific studies looking at this and measuring, and in general, freezing is pretty good at keeping nutrient content. Sometimes it's even better than buying fresh, because in reality, we don't eat everything the day we buy it. It sits in the fridge for a couple days, and by the time we eat it, the frozen product may actually have more nutrition preserved because it degrades slower. So studies have actually measured and shown that. Now, leafy greens may be a bit of an outlier. Freezing things like spinach can cause some nutrients, like some vitamins, for example, their level can come down by 25% or so. But depending how long your vegetables sit in the fridge, if you buy them fresh, the difference between refrigerated and frozen isn't that big. The other factor, of course, is waste. Sometimes vegetables sit in the fridge too long, they go bad, and we have to toss them. So buying frozen can actually result in saving some ka-ching and, of course, less environmental impact, because that's less food that gets produced only to be thrown away. Now, one caveat of preserved food are the additives. Canned beans, for example, can come with a lot of sodium added, and canned fruit sometimes comes in this sugary, syrupy water. So those are some things to look out for, but in general, frozen fruits and vegetables are pretty good options. Myth number two, all fat is bad. Yeah, this is a relic from the 20th century, from last century, and I still see this here and there on social media. I think what happens is sometimes people lose weight on a low-fat diet, and then they get told, see, it was the fat you took out that's unhealthy. It's not. We can lose weight on all kinds of diets. It doesn't necessarily mean that the thing we left out is automatically unhealthy. You just cut out a source of calories. Eating too many calories is bad for us, whether it's from fat or not. One problem with the fat phobia is people can be drawn to buy and consume ultra-processed foods labeled low-fat or no-fat added and end up eating a lot of refined carbohydrates. I know most viewers of this channel wouldn't fall for that, but that's a pretty common problem. Now, some people like to eat low-fat diets mostly from whole foods, and that's completely fine as a personal preference. But we don't have to fear fat. The question is not so much the amount of fat, it's the type of fat. As the professor of medicine from UCLA who contributed this section writes, saturated and trans fats can increase your risk of heart disease or stroke, while healthy fats like mono and polyunsaturated help reduce risk. So vegetable oils, avocados, nuts, seeds, fatty fish, etc. We've actually covered this topic in a lot of previous content. We went over all the evidence, all the cohort studies, all the trials. So we're not going to spend too much time on this. We're going to move on to myth number three. And I know there's still uncertainty because we hear all kinds of things on social media, but we're going to keep going over the evidence in the future, and we'll bring on as many lipid researchers as we need so people have clarity and are satisfied on all this. All right, myth number three, calories in, calories out is the most important factor for long-term weight gain. So this one I found strange. I read it several times. It's still not clear to me exactly what he means. This one was contributed by Darius Mozafarian, who's a professor of nutrition at Tufts. And he says the critical thing for weight loss is avoiding ultra-processed foods. I agree with that in general. And he recommends a shift from counting calories to prioritizing healthy eating overall. Quality over quantity. Agree 100%. Focusing on healthy foods tends to take care of the calorie problem. I just think the title is weird, how he worded it, the myth he chose, right? Calories in, calories out being the most important factor for weight gain. That's the top myth for him. It's true that conscious focus on calories doesn't seem helpful for most people, but that doesn't mean calories in, calories out isn't a key factor. In fact, we know that eating ultra-processed foods leads to overconsumption of calories. So they're not mutually exclusive. I think his wording conflates best approaches with what the underlying physiological factors might be. But let me know in the comments if you disagree and if you interpret his words differently. I agree with his bottom line though, minimizing ultra-processed foods in general and focusing on quality foods. It's just, I would have worded the myth as something like, focusing on calories is the best approach for weight loss, or trying to eat less is the best approach for weight loss, something like that, and then explain that it's better to focus on eating better instead of eating less. Myth number four, people with type 2 diabetes shouldn't eat fruit. Yeah, this is a pretty common one to hear. I think it comes from fruit containing sugars, even though they're natural sugars, in the food matrix with fiber. But there's this notion that sugars of any source are bad for diabetes. I don't have a 100% black and white position on this. The balance of evidence doesn't seem to support that whole fruit is a problem for diabetics. We know people who eat more fruit tend to have a lower risk of developing type 2 diabetes, and type 2 diabetics who eat more fruit tend to have a lower risk of complications and even mortality. Now, we can always argue, well, maybe it's some other healthy habit that they have, it's not the fruit itself. So we also want to see, ideally, when available, some randomized trials. I've seen a few trials specifically looking at whole fruit separate from vegetables in a population with type 2 diabetes. This one, for example, told half the participants to eat a bit more fruit and the other half to eat a little bit less. And after 3 months, they didn't see a significant difference in body weight or hemoglobin A1C, which is an average of the glucose levels over the long run. Several caveats of this study that lower my confidence a little. For example, the difference in fruit intake was subtle. Before the trial, they ate about 190 grams of fruit a day, average, which is the equivalent of a medium apple. And during the trial, one group went up to 320 grams a day, and the other came down to 135. So it's like comparing an apple and a half to two-thirds of an apple. So the trial is saying that in the background of a whole dietary pattern, eating a little more than an apple a day versus a little less than an apple in type 2 diabetics doesn't seem to make a big difference for glucose levels. And I have no trouble believing that. I'm not knocking the trial. This is a common hurdle, getting people to achieve significantly different levels of intake, what we call contrast of exposure. In an ideal world, we'd like to see one group eat no fruit or close to it, and the other group eat 5 or 6 pieces a day. And if we still see no difference, then that's pretty compelling that fruit by itself doesn't seem to play a huge role. Another source of uncertainty is they don't specify what people ate instead of the fruit. Fruit normally replaces other desserts or snacks, so people cutting back on fruit might eat something worse instead. Another factor to bear in mind is heterogeneity. Just saying fruit is a very large category. I think it's entirely possible that different fruits may have different effects, particularly for people with defective metabolism like diabetics. For example, in this study, blueberries, bananas, apples and pears, and grapefruit were associated with lower type 2 diabetes risk. Peaches and oranges with no significant difference, and cantaloupe was associated with a higher risk of type 2. Usual caveats apply. I'm not saying this demonstrates cause and effect and cantaloupes make us diabetic, but I think this raises the possibility of heterogeneity between fruit types. So what about trials looking at specific fruits? I've seen some with berries, for example, and they generally seem to improve metabolic parameters like glucose, insulin, and inflammatory markers, both in diabetics and in healthy people. I've also seen some trials with grapes meta-analyzed, and they don't find a significant effect on glucose or insulin of whole grapes, although the trials that looked at whole grapes were not in diabetics. They were in healthy people. Also seen a couple trials with dates, generally finding lower glycemia and no significant change in hemoglobin A1C. So the data I've seen doesn't point to a clear issue with fruit in type 2 diabetics, with the usual uncertainty around types of fruit and amount and replacement, etc. As we discussed recently with Dr. Nick Lagess, the main factor for type 2 diabetes remission is weight loss. And people have different strategies for that. Some people put type 2 diabetes in remission with high fruit diets. Others with low-carb diets, where they have some low-carb fruits like berries, and they generally avoid more sugary fruits like mangoes and bananas. Both approaches can work, at least for weight loss and type 2 diabetes remission. So overall, I agree the statement diabetics shouldn't eat fruit is not supported by the evidence. At the same time, I don't think it's unreasonable necessarily for some diabetics to choose a strategy where they focus on specific fruits, or even where they reduce the amount of fruit they were eating before, depending on specifics. I think it's less about whether you eat fruit or not, and more about what you eat instead. I think this gets into the obsession with glucose levels to the point where we lose track of big picture. Overall health including glucose levels, and dietary pattern, healthy overall, whether it includes a little bit more or a little bit less fruit. Okay, myth number 5. Plant milk is healthier than cow milk. And the professor who wrote this one, she's very categorical. She says, it's just not true. I'm less sure than she is. I would say that I'm agnostic on this question because I just haven't seen health outcome data on plant milks. And I see a lot of people jumping to conclusions on this. It seems to be a very emotional issue. Some people saying, well, of course the plant milk is going to be healthier. It's from a plant. It's not from an animal. And some people saying the opposite. Of course it's going to be unhealthier. It's a processed food. I don't find either of these arguments compelling. It's not true that all animal foods are unhealthy or even that all processed foods are unhealthy. So to me, it just sounds like logical leaps. It's one thing to say, my general strategy is to avoid processed foods. Cool, don't see a problem with that. Or in general, ultra-processed foods aren't great staples. Agree with that. It's a completely different statement to say, we know that this product is less healthy than that product when we lack the evidence for it. It's okay to say, we don't know. We should normalize saying, we don't have the data on that yet, we're waiting. We don't have to rush to form an unshakable opinion on every question before we go through the evidence. I know that's what social media promotes, the algorithm, but I don't think that's very productive. Now, the writer of this section offers a couple arguments. One is protein content, which is higher in cow milk than in almond or oat milk. But for example, soy milk has as much protein as cow milk. Depending on the brand, it even has more. I just don't think protein content necessarily equates with healthier product. Now, if you have someone getting a substantial amount of their protein from cow milk, and they do a one-to-one swap, volume for volume, with oat milk, and they don't change anything else about their diet, yeah, you might run into some problems there, especially if it's like a child, right? So I agree with that. I just don't think it's as simple as this food is healthier, period. The scientist also points out many plant milks have added stuff like sodium and added sugars. I think it's totally fine to point that out and to bear that in mind. It just doesn't tell me which product is healthier. Which milk product leads to better health? I don't know. Happy to lean in either direction when the solid evidence comes out. I don't consume either one, so I don't have a horse in this race. And honestly, it wouldn't surprise me if the data pointed in either direction or if the data showed that they're about equal. None of it would blow me away. Bottom line, if the argument is that assuming plant milk must be healthier is not justified, then I agree. Myth number 6, white potatoes are bad for you. This is another one where I don't quite share the level of confidence of the writer to make this a top myth. In part, potatoes get a bad rep because in the West, most people tend to eat them fried. When method of preparation is accounted for, French fries are associated with worse outcomes. As far as non-fried, baked or boiled or mashed potatoes, I've seen a bit of mixed evidence. Many studies don't show a significant effect, but I've seen one or two that show a statistically significant increase in, for example, risk of type 2 diabetes with intake of non-fried potatoes. Lots of uncertainty with this, very small effect, haven't seen any trials pointing in the same direction. Could it be the gravy or the sour cream or whatever people put on potatoes? Absolutely. If I had to guess, a baked potato or a boiled potato here and there in a healthy dietary pattern, I'd be surprised if it's a big deal. But I'm not at this level of confidence. I wouldn't put it as a top myth. Open to being convinced, though, if there's a strong balance of evidence. Myth number 7, never give peanuts to small kids. Right, this used to be the recommendation, but it changed. There was a fascinating randomized trial published in 2015 giving little kids under 1 year old peanut products like peanut butter lowered their risk of developing peanut allergy by several fold. It was a stunning result. As a result of this trial and other evidence, the guidelines changed, and introduction of peanut products early on is now recommended, especially in kids with eczema and other hints that they might go on to develop a peanut allergy. There's even some evidence that existing peanut allergy can be put in remission with a very gradual, very careful reintroduction of the allergen, of peanut proteins. We've covered this in previous videos. There's some very striking evidence showing 74% of kids with peanut allergies achieving remission after this treatment. Obviously, if your child has peanut allergy, don't start giving them peanuts on your own randomly without medical supervision. All right? This is a very specific, very careful process. I'm going to say that again. Do not give kids with peanut allergies peanuts on your own randomly without medical supervision. But in general, introducing these foods early in life is now recommended, and it's thought not only to not be a problem, but to actually reduce the risk of developing the allergy. Myth number 8, plant protein is incomplete. This one was contributed by Christopher Gardner, who is a Stanford professor, and we had him on not too long ago on the channel. We're not gonna spend a ton of time on this because we have a lot of videos going into this in detail. All plants contain all 9 essential amino acids. It's the proportion that varies. If your whole diet is one plant all day, every day, like in some developing countries, 80% of the calories come from wheat. Yeah, you might run into problems. You might not get enough of some essential amino acids. Otherwise, if you have a diverse diet, some vegetables, some beans, some grains, and you're getting enough calories, not a problem. There are a lot of trials now looking at muscle growth, which is a pretty high bar for protein adequacy, and even comparing people getting all of their protein from plants versus omnivores, they don't find a statistically significant difference in muscle growth as long as people are getting enough protein overall. One amino acid that seems particularly important is leucine, so see our protein videos for more details on that. Myth number 9, soy raises risk of breast cancer. Yeah, this is a common one to hear. These concerns with soy and hormones stem from the fact that soy contains phytoestrogens, which are molecules that bear some resemblance to mammalian estrogen. And we have a whole video on this looking at testosterone levels and man boobs and all that. The key to this whole dilemma is that phytoestrogens are kind of like a two-faced molecule. In some tissues, they act like estrogen, while in other tissues, they do the opposite. So we actually have to look at what happens in a living, breathing human in order to know what the health effect of the food is. Studies find, if anything, an inverse correlation between breast cancer and consumption of soy and isoflavones, which are some of these phytoestrogens in soy. So people eating the most soy, the most isoflavones have, if anything, lower risk of breast cancer, better survival rates, and lower risk of recurrence. And the trials that have been carried out looking at breast cancer markers also don't support the notion that soy or isoflavone consumption promotes breast cancer growth. Concerns about soy and hormones also stem from some work in mice showing faster tumor growth. The problem is also mice are known to process isoflavones differently from humans. So it's just another example that animal research can be very important for hypothesis generation, but it doesn't necessarily reflect what happens in a human. So at the end of the day, we want to look at human data. I would summarize the evidence conservatively. I would say the balance of evidence does not support this concern with soy and breast cancer. And finally, myth number 10, nutrition advice keeps changing. Professor Marion Nessel explains that since the 1950s, dietary recommendations have been basically similar on the fundamentals, not going overboard on calories and minimizing saturated fat and added salt and sugar. Of course, there's lots of research ongoing, and nutrition scientists are not unemployed, and views on specific questions evolve, just like we saw with the peanut example and timing of introduction for kids. But the notion that nutrition science as a whole, the whole field, keeps doing 180s every week is just not true. Headlines and social media can give that impression, but that's not an accurate reflection of how science in general evolves. Now, I've noticed a lot of people asking this question recently. If the guidelines have been the same, essentially the same, for decades, and if we're getting sicker, at least in the West, especially in the US, doesn't that mean the guidelines are wrong? So we have a whole video addressing this question coming very soon, so stay tuned. So out of the 10 myths, I agree with the authors on most of them. There's maybe 3 or 4 that I have doubts about, I have questions. Let me know in the comments how many you agree with. Here's more detail on protein and bioavailability, and here's more on soy and hormones. I'll see you over there.